I want to tell you guys a story. It's the Zoroastrian creation myth. Zoroastrianism was the state religion of ancient Iran from 600 BC until the year 650. Its prophet was Zoroaster, or also known as Zarathustra. Zoroastrianism was of great influence on philosophy and other religions, on the ideas of good and evil, heaven and hell, and so also the Lord's judgment and free will. So let's start with the story. First there was Zurvan, but actually it's a distinct branch of Zoroastrianism that's called Zurvanism, that believes that Zurvan was the first creating principle instead of its son Ormazd. But since Zurvan is so interesting to me, I really want to mention it. It has no gender, so it's... And after the myth, I will get deeper into Zurvan because it's really, really interesting. So, okay, so again, first there was Zurvan, and Zurvan was infinite time and space. It had no gender. It was as well feminine as masculine. And because of that, it didn't need anything to reproduce. Also, it was very neutral. It was neither good or evil. At one point, Zurvan decided that it wanted to create an almighty good god. It had to make sacrifices for that. And so it became pregnant of Ormazd, also known as Ahura Mazda, and that means wise lord. But in a moment of doubt, Zurvan also begot Ahriman, also known as Angra Mainyu. Zurvan said that the first one who would be born would be omniscient and almighty, and it would be the god of delight and goodness. When Ahriman heard this, he tore open the womb, got out, and told Zurvan, "I'm Ormazd, I'm the almighty." But then it was clear to Zurvan that he was not, because he smelled really bad and he was all dark. And so Zurvan exiled him to the darkness. Contrary to Ahriman, Ormazd was omniscient and a beacon of light. He was all good. And eventually he would defeat Ahriman. But in order to do that, he had to set a time limit. He had to start time. So he set 12,000 years. In the first 3,000 years, Ahriman resided in the darkness, and Ormazd created the spiritual world. He created a lot of light, and he was the light himself. And after those 3,000 years, Ahriman saw the light, and he became jealous and came to it, and he wanted to attack it. But then Ormazd offered peace to Ahriman. But in order to establish peace, Ahriman had to honor the creation of Ormazd. But he didn't want to do that, because Ahriman was all evil and he just wanted to destroy everything that was good. So he turned the offer down. So Ormazd proposed a time limit to Ahriman for their final battle. That would be 9,000 years. Because Ormazd is omniscient, he knew that eventually he would beat Ahriman. But Ahriman was unable to foresee his own defeat, so he accepted. So in the next 3,000 years, Ormazd created the material world. He created the sky, water, earth, plants, but also fire, that is light. And he created the sacred ox and the first perfect human being called Gayomart. He filled the ox and Gayomart with seeds so they could reproduce. After those 3,000 years, Ahriman came and he attacked the creation of Ormazd. He attacked the sky and made it dark. Then he attacked the earth and filled it with noxious creatures. He went through the earth to the primordial waters and he made it bitter. Then he attacked the ox and Gayomart and he murdered them. And finally, he attacked fire and he mixed it with smoke and made it dark. So eventually, Ahriman created everything on earth that is evil. He filled the earth with snakes and insects, and he introduced decay and death. Then the six protection spirits waged war against Ahriman. First, the spirit of the sky made sure that Ahriman was not to leave the material creation of Ormazd. Then, the water deity, called Tistar, defeated the demon of the drought, and he produced so much rain that the earth was completely flooded. Because of this, all the noxious animals were killed, and the venom was washed away from the earth. Also, because of all this water, the oceans and rivers were formed. The mountains were also formed, but that's because the earth trembled because of the attack of Ahriman. Amardat was the spirit of the plant, and he mixed this with water and gave it to Tistar, the water deity. Tistar poured it all over the earth, and this way a lot of different plants grew. These would make all the creatures immune to all the diseases that Ahriman miscreated. When the ox died, different kinds of medical plants grew up from his limbs. Then his seed was purified by the moon. The moon is the feminine. And from the seed, a lot of different animals came into being. Then Ormazd created all the souls of all the people that will ever be born. And they incarcerated Ahriman so that the earth could repair itself. When Gaiomar died, then there were seven kinds of metal that came out of his body. From his soul came gold. Then his seed was purified by the sun. Then his body went into the earth, the womb, the feminine, for 40 years. And then a rhubarb plant grew out of that. Ormazd changed the rhubarb plants into the first two human beings, Mashiach and Mashiach. Their descendants would eventually beat Ahriman. So it was important for Ormazd that they would reproduce. But then Ahriman told them a lie, which they believed. And a lie is the biggest sin. The lie was that Ahriman created all the good on earth. They believed the lie and they spread it. They even sacrificed the sacred ox to Ahriman, which is also a very great sin. What is very interesting is that not only here is the ox a sacred animal, you can also see this in the Bible. A cherubim, which is the highest angel, has the face of an ox, a lion, an eagle, and a human. Also, in the Christmas story, when Christ was born, there is an ox. So, yeah, the ox is a sacred animal, and they sacrificed it to Ahriman. Because of their sins, they learned about life and about suffering, and they didn't want to reproduce anymore. But they had to, and after 50 years, they reproduced twins, but they ate them. But because Ormazd really wanted them to reproduce, he made them fertile again, and eventually they had a few children. So that was the end of the myth, and there's a lot of symbolism in the story. I already explained a bit about the ox, but we can also see the motive of the hostile brothers. So Ormazd and Ahriman are the hostile brothers. We can also see this in Cain and Abel and Romulus and Remus, and there are way more stories about this. We can also recognize the flood motif, that the earth was flooded, and this is also very archetypical. And the seed of the ox that was purified by the moon, that is the feminine, and the seed of Gaiomart, the man, that was purified by the sun, which is the masculine. And then he goes into the earth, in the womb, in the feminine. And so here we can clearly see that there's a unity between the masculine and the feminine. And now I want to get back to Zurvan, because to me this is really interesting. As you can see, Zurvan is depicted with a snake twirling around his body. This statue could not only be Zurvan, but it could also be Ion, which is the Hellenistic god of eternity. But it could also be Phanes or Phanes, I don't know how to pronounce that, which is also an Hellenistic deity, but that's from Orphism. He is the first creating principle of Orphic cosmology. He hatched from the Orphic egg, which is the primordial mixture of all elements. And here we can also see the snake twirling around the egg. But this image we can see in way more things, in also in everyday life, which makes it so interesting. So let me name a few examples in which we can see this. So first of all, we can see the snake twirling around a tree in the Garden of Eden, in the story of Adam and Eve in Genesis, in the Bible. So a snake in the tree, that's actually quite similar to a snake twirling around a human body, as we can see in these deities. Because in the symbolic sense, a tree and a human being are quite similar. The roots of the tree are in the earth, like the feet of a human being are connected to the earth, to the feminine also, to the unknown, to hell. And so the stem of the tree is like the spinal cord. And so the branches of the tree that reach up to heaven are like the brain of the human being. And we can also see this pattern in the Christmas tree, in which the lights or the ribbons go around the tree up to the top. It's like a hierarchy. So this snake, the lights, ribbons, they form a sort of ladder towards the top. But also it goes around the tree, it goes away from the center and it goes back to the center. And the center is the perfection, and you shouldn't go too far away from the center because otherwise things will fall apart. And maybe this doesn't make any sense right now because it's a whole other story. But I suggest that you watch the lecture of Jonathan Pageau about this. I put the link down below. It's a very great lecture. I totally love it. And it's very nice to suddenly see the world in this light. Another everyday symbol in which we can recognize the snake twirling around something is the rod of Asclepius. Asclepius made a medicine from the blood of the Gorgon, that was a snake-like monster from antiquity. And he made this medicine from the right side of the Gorgon and not the left side, because the left side was poisonous. We can see the idea of the left being evil and the right being good more often. I also explained this in my video about Black Pete. And so we can also see this motive back in this story of Asclepius. But what's also interesting is that this idea of using the blood of the snake, of the evil thing, as medicine, because that's like a vaccine. You use the disease to fight the disease. That's very interesting. So there's this great book by Mathieu Pageau, who is the brother of Jonathan Pageau. It's called The Language of Creation, and there he explains that this pattern of the snake in the tree is also like time and space, in which the snake is time. And you can use these terms by explaining so many things. And so in this symbol of the rod of Asclepius, he also explained that so meat is like the snake, is like time. Because eventually meat, it withers. And the bones, they will stay, they won't wither. And so meat, since it dissolves by time, is like the snake. It's the snake around the bone. And the stick is then the bone that is like space, that won't wither. And so he has a lot of these explanations in his book, and it's really amazing. So I should all recommend you to read this book. There's also this part of Exodus in which the Israelites are being attacked by snakes. And then God tells Moses to create this bronze snake and put it on a staff. and everybody who looks at it won't be affected by the snake bites, while people who won't look at it will die of the snake bites. Here we can see more or less the same thing. It's like a vaccine. The snake itself is being used as a medicine against the poison of the snake. I believe that eventually the idea is that you have to transcend the evil and use it in order to become good. And that's also what Jung explained, that he was talking about the shadow in the unconscious of people. The shadow is like a snake. It's the evil in our own unconscious. And then when we transcend it, we can use it to become good. And that's what happens with these snakes. And that's why they're not on the floor, but they're twirled around something. Because you need the evil. You need to understand evil to solve it. It's like a problem. If you don't understand the problem, you can solve it. But once you understand it, it's solvable. And so that's also the case with this. You need to understand evil. You need to transcend the evil. You need to take it up, make it more like vertical, but it's at the same time horizontal because it goes like this. And then you can solve, let's say, the problem of evil. There's also the dollar sign that has this same pattern. And last but not least, you could also say that Jesus on the cross is like this pattern, is like the snake twirling around the stick, the rod, the tree. And so eventually there are so many symbols and images in which we can see this pattern. To me, it's really amazing and interesting that we can also see this back in the image of Zurvan from the Zoroastrian myth. I hope that I did a bit of a good job explaining everything, and I hope that this was interesting to you guys. And I hope that you learned something, of course.